Hello, this is Captain Poodle speaking. Are you ready to find love?
Yes, ahoy, matey.
Love.
Do-do-do-do.
Exciting and new. Go online. They're catfishing you.
Shocker.
Fiance.
Soon you'll be flying to parts unknown.
90-day Beyonce.
Marrying someone you only met on your phone.
Be they French or Chinese, a brand new K-1 visa's the key.
Ooh, the key to what, Poodle?
To love.
It's reality, yeah. Let's love.
Church! Church! The SAG strike is over, so we may now talk about the Gilded Age.
Oh, God. Y'all, if you could see that wig.
I'm wearing my Bertha Russell wig.
Wow. It's looked better. It's seen better days.
I tell you, someone's been into it, and you've used it in your bedroom.
Maybe. It's my out of Africa look.
Yeah, it's something.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's Africa, but it's out of something.
It's out of somewhere. It's out of somewhere. It's definitely out.
Sorry, y'all. If you're watching the Intimate Portrait right now, which is on our $15 tier.
I'm wearing my Bertha Russell wig because the Gilded Age is back. And I can talk about it now because we can promote SAG Strike Project or the projects that were struck.
I know, because we are a SAG podcast and we are proud of the SAG for like sticking to their guns and getting us a deal. And
I get to, and
I'm so excited because the Marvels comes out tonight when we're recording this. I can't wait. It's a new Marvel movie.
I've only seen the one with Brie Larson.
Uh-huh.
I've never seen the other. I know one is a character
one's a character on WandaVision.
Oh, that's her.
Yeah, it's Monica Rambeau, the pretty black woman from, and then the adorable.
How did she get to be Miss Marvel or whatever?
Sorry, we're going to have a little bit of comic book corner, but basically.
Can you make this short?
I can't use their names because you won't know who Carol Danvers is, but Brie Larson.
Carol Danvers, yeah.
Okay, Carol Larson's best friend. She had a, remember in the first movie, she had a black woman who was like her co-pilot friend?
Yeah.
This is her daughter, the one that's in WandaVision.
Got it.
In the Marvels. And then the third person is from, what's the show on Marvel? It was great.
The Disney Plus thing. I didn't watch it, but.
What the fuck is that show called?
Little Miss Marvel.
It's actually called Ms. Marvel, not Little Miss Marvel, but Ms. Marvel. It was great.
The magical Marvelette.
They should call them the Marvelettes. I agree with that. Anyway, I'm excited.
I gotta take this off.
Yeah, you gotta take. You're gonna do it. You're gonna do your corner later. Oh no, it's stuck to the headphones.
There will be a Gilded Age corner. On later on in the show. But y'all, this is 90-day Beyonce. We're reality gays. I realize sometimes with the way our shows start, people wouldn't have no fucking clue what was going on.
No, they wouldn't know at all. We are reality gays. I'm Maddie and you are Jake, aka
I'm
Poodle.
Bertha Russell.
No,
that's
you're
who
Poodle.
I am. That my pronouns are Bertha and Russell.
You're way too fired up. You're going to be
especially
crazy this
season.
Episode.
Oh my God! When Laura Benanti came out, I haven't watched it.
I do want to watch.
Of course, you haven't.
Y'all, this is season 10, episode 6. If anyone objects to this union, this is our part one of. We will have two parts. Very quickly, Big Brother. What? It's the big night, right?
Tonight, we're recording this on Thursday. So this is the night of the Big Brother finale. If you're listening to this on Sunday or whenever the fuck you're listening to it,
you should make a prediction.
Everyone's already forgotten about it.
They have.
Before we start the show, I want to say I think people really thought that this was going to be an exciting season because of Ceri. I think they really shit the bed. And you can never know by who you choose. But I think the production, they did too many twists this season. Mm. It was like a scramble verse and a scary verse and a humiliverse. I don't know. There were too many bells and whistles this season. And its top three is Matt, Jag, and Bowie Jane. And the final three, I should say. I can see a way in which all three of them could win. I think on the Toe podcast, you heard me make an apology. In other words, I I'm sorry, but a Bowie Jane apology is an idea where how she could win and she possibly could win the show. Because Jag may have gotten his hands too dirty and Matt's gameplay may not have, in a weird way, even though Bowie Jane has been the ultimate floater, Matt's gameplay hasn't been that great either. But everyone likes him. So it's going to come down to no one gives a shit about this because that was already happened. But I could see a way where if the jury is bitter, if you got a bunch of bitter Bettys on the jury where they're taking everything personal, Jag will not win. What I'm thinking, though, is it all depends on who the people take to the jury. If Jag takes Matt, which is the stupidest idea, but I could see him doing it out of loyalty because they've been together from the beginning. I think it'll depend on how bitter the jury is. I guarantee you Felicia and Blue are going to give their votes to Matt just out of bitterness because that's the way some of these people are. I could see Cam and Corey and even Ceri giving their votes to Jag. And then America is the wild card. I don't know what would happen.
Again, it sounds like a gay porn still.
It does. It kind of does.
It does.
America
it does.
The wild card. if either of them take Bowie Jane to the final two, they either of them got it in the bag, I think. However, I still think there's ways for Bowie Jane to win. And that would, to me, that would be the ultimate absurdity. And then cats would lie down with dogs. And I kind of want that for this world. So, y'all, that's the end of BB Corner. I can't say it's been a good ride, but it was a ride.
You better apply for next season.
I will wreak havoc in that house.
You're going to do it. I'm just going to have to come over to your house.
I'll be
and
worse
film
than
you.
Heisem.
And I'll have Christina. Christina and I are just going to have to do it for you.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, no shit. Speaking of more reality TV, though, I want to tell everybody this an episode on Tuesday of this week is going to drop. I was on my friend Laura Tremaine, her podcast, 10 Things to Tell You.
Laura Tremaine.
And
I just want to say their name like that.
People of the Sissy Squad, and we talked about it on the show, she also wrote a book called The Life Council, which is about how women can find friendships in adult life.
We wanted to have this woman on.
I know, but we got busy with life, so eventually we are going to have her on the pod. Mainly, Poodle wants to talk to her because her kind of work, her life's work is getting women to authentically connect, and I love that about and building communication and connectivity. But she's from Ardmore, Oklahoma, y'all. We were telling Oklahoma. We gossiped for an hour and a half before
That's
we even
so
started
fucking
the show.
Annoying.
She offered me a Dr. Pepper when I walked in the room. It was very sweet. So, again, her podcast is called 10 Things to Tell You. My friend, Laura Tremaine. We ironically didn't know each other at all. And now we know each other here in L.A. Anyway.
The power of Oklahoma.
It's true. Speaking of, too,
riveting.
Because I'm already getting inundated. I have heard there's a new flavor of Dr. Pepper called Hot Dr. Pepper. I appreciate all your Instagram messages and your TikTok reshares. I got it.
Who gives a shit?
Well, they know I like Dr. Pepper.
No, I mean, like, why don't you just warm up some Dr. Pepper in the microwave?
No, it's like with chili, some type of chili, and it's like a spicy hot Dr. Pepper, like with jalapeno.
Oh. Yeah. I'm sorry. I just can't get excited.
It's fine. I bet sissies are, so thank you. Any other announcements, Boots? Did we talk about Game of Roses that aired last week on this show? I don't know if we ever did.
I don't know. We were on Game of Roses to talk about The Golden Bachelor, and we talked about 90 Day, especially Toe. We talked about the enigma, the mystery, the wonder that is Sarper, and the weird things he says. We had a good time talking. With those guys.
Chad and Lizzie, yes.
Chad and Lizzie.
We had a good time.
Lizzie is my Lizzie. Blue suit pressed.
I don't think
no one knows that.
No.
That's from 110 in the Shade. Simple Little Things.
Nobody knows.
Sometimes I say musical theater things that I think a lot of people will know. And then sometimes I say things that are just the most obscure that alienates the entire audience.
It's mostly that latter one, just so you know. I think that Selling Sunset season 7, be sure to check that out. You are being double virused in November.
Speaking of double virus, thank you for, I've thanked them before, but thank you for DocuSweeties for filling in for me. I am almost on the mend. You'll hear me coughing sometimes. I'm trying to mute sometimes. That's why we're remote today, because if we were in person, I would not be able to mute my coughing.
I don't want a sickness.
I'm not sick anymore. It's just the leftover shit.
Yeah, I don't know.
My voice actually still sounds better than yours.
As much dick as you've had and many STIs, I feel like things just hang on for you.
They use my blood for just a petri dish.
Yes.
I just wanted to say, I wasn't on last week's show.
I was going to ask you, is there anything that was on your mind from last week?
A couple of things I wanted to say that I think are first for this. I think last week's episode was incredible.
It was great. It was a great episode.
I don't think I ever saw a more misogynistic scene than when Rob and Torai, who was coked out of his brain.
I never know people that did coke, because I wasn't around it like you are.
Or something, meth or something. Y'all, she couldn't even blink her eyes. She was so coked out. But he was like, oh, you know, women are capable of anything. And the piling on of how we can casually talk about women, it was disgusting.
It was pretty gross.
Not since Big Ed have we heard talk like this.
Think Rob's hot now? Yes, you do.
I can objectively see him as attractive, but he is one of the biggest pieces of shit we've had.
I'm not a fan.
I don't know if he has fans. I'm sure. I just wanted to bring that up. I still wrote down, why are Nikki and Justin still in Moldova? We're six episodes in. You're on the wrong fucking show.
I don't think we're going to see him come over. Because really, this is before the 90 days.
Especially feels like them. Clayton and Alani. I kept thinking, what does this apartment smell like?
Oh, something to do with gerbils, for sure.
It can't be good. There's dirty hair in there. There's dirty hair. There's cedar shavings, like a faint soupçon of feces.
Yes.
Clayton has, I need to point this out because I'm going to go insane if I don't. Clayton has baby hands. And they bother the shit out of me. They're tiny. And you know if when he was playing computer, I saw them. And you know if you touch them, they'd be so soft.
Maybe. He has pretty eyes, really pretty blue eyes.
He's I'm indifferent about him altogether. I think this is the first time we've actually had a fiance who possibly might eat a pet.
Yeah, that's true.
And I think it's a concern. I need to talk about, maybe you guys talked about Nick and Devin, the fact that they, when they're eating those chicken skewers, they couldn't close their fucking mouths.
Yeah, the three of us didn't bring that up.
It looked like two cows chewing cud. It was awful. Sorry, these are the things that I noticed.
Okay,
and
great.
Also, there's something about her that reminds me of if someone fused the DNA of a human with a bird. I don't know what it is.
She also
barely opens her mouth when she talks like Sean Taylor.
She's real,
y'all, this woman was not made for television. And,
no, she was not. She is uncomfortable.
And but you and Jasmine, I was just thinking, who replaces their pillows every six months? Like that woman said.
Well, if you buy cheap pillows, that you should.
No one replaces their pillows.
But I don't think so. But I buy a nice pillow. I keep my pillow for like probably, I don't know, 10 years. I think I still, yeah, I still have the same.
I think I throw mine away like every 2 or 3 years. But 6 months?
Jesus.
Anyway, those were some thoots I had.
All right, some poots, that I
had to say. I also thought that Rob, the other thing I thought about Rob is he might be the most joyless person we've ever seen on 90 Day. Who's more joyless?
They were a couple. They lived in Los Angeles. They got married in a park.
Oh, you know, but no, Blake was not all bad.
No, not Blake. His wife. What is her name?
Jasmine.
Well,
I agree.
She's a robot.
She, you know what? She was joyless, but she was also Finnish. So she has that excuse of being Scandinavian. Rob has no excuse. Has Rob laughed once?
I think Rob is so concerned with how people perceive Rob.
Ugh. God, I hate this guy. I hate him almost as much as Sophie's mother hates him.
That's saying something because she hates him.
Hates him. But I just wanted to talk about that, and then we can move on to this week.
All right, let's jump in.
I
oddly don't have really that much Oklahoma stories. From being home in Oklahoma, really. So I got them out.
No, you already talked about them. No, you had a lot. You had a lot when you were there.
Well, maybe I say put it on the Patreon, but anyway, we'll see if something comes to me. But I'm back in LA now, thankfully.
Let's just jump in.
All right, Rob and Sophie. You know, he's outside because, you know, they don't have a room.
Because his... it's probably kind of claustrophobic in there, and he probably needed that way he could go to the bathroom if he wants.
Mm-hmm.
She's in a completely different place. Like last week when they said, Sophie, I hear a car alarm.
Oh, you do?
Yeah. When they said Sophie has moved out of Rob's place. Boy, how long was that? How long was she there?
They're on day 70, so they made it 20 days.
Day 70?
Oh. At the beginning of the day, we said day 70 of the 90 days.
No, it should be day 20.
They count down.
Oh, 70 days until. So not 70 day days 70.
Left. 70 days left until the night, yes.
So she made it 20 days in that place without an indoor bathroom.
I realized when watching this, we showed her in this place that actually has a bathroom in it, I wasn't worried about her. I went, I'm not worried about her because she's rich. And yes, she's alone, but she lives in LA. This is in LA in an international city. She can just get on a flight back to LAX. It's not a big deal.
Yeah. She can get on Bumble Friends and find everybody.
She can find
Bumble BFF.
Bumble BFF.
I'm still annoyed at that charade of last week of making this woman feel like shit and feeling like an adulterer and a cheater after what we saw this week.
It was pretty gross. It was pretty gross.
And anyway, what happened was she said she's like, I had a dream. And, you know, my dreams can often be quite intuitive. So my dreams are, I will say, 90% of the people who tell you in Los Angeles who say I'm quite intuitive are full of shit.
It's true.
Maybe she is. When you hear that, you'd hear that.
I don't think she is.
I think, you know what it is? I think it was more, there's other things she's picking up than just being dreams. And she said, for some reason, I just looked at his phone and I saw these messages from this girl 14 months ago when they were together.
Yeah.
And not like when they were on a break.
Yeah.
No. And he's like, I don't even know this girl. This was just random pre-porn. That's a great excuse.
Great excuse.
When someone says, someone just sent them to me. I don't know how I got them. Now, remember, it seems like she was angry. I don't know what this was. She's like, and then I found these disgusting videos. Did she find like dick videos and like jerk off videos that he sent her after that?
We need to know. I feel like if she wants to send the videos to us just for us to inspect.
I need to, for research purposes.
Yes. She says disgusting. So like what, so disgusting for me, and I'm a gay man who's had sex with quite a few men. And so for me, disgusting would be like, I'm not into this, so I don't like to use the word disgusting, but what's not for me is like, I don't know, like someone pooping on someone else. I'd be like,
yeah,
ugh,
scat.
Wouldn't like that, scat. That's disgusting for me. I would like to ask you, Poodle, if you were watching a sex video, what would actually be disgusting for you?
I don't know. I'm not... I don't like scat or blood or anything like that. I'm not into that.
Mm-hmm.
Besides that, the world's your oyster. Do anything you want. I'm not really into people peeing on people, but I'll just fast forward through it. I think she's 23 and she's extremely sheltered. And she's,
I think that.
Yeah, I don't think she's seen a lot of porn. A lot of hardcore porn.
Yeah. I don't think she's seen Mexican cum sluts.
Or Colombian cum cannons.
Cannons.
Sophie, just come on Piano Cat 77 site any night of the week and you'll get an education.
We'll leave with her eyes wide.
It's like Clockwork Orange. Then she calls her mom, who you can't convince me this is not a Dawn French character of French and Saunders. Do you know who that is? Jennifer Saunders from Absolutely Fabulous, and Dawn French was her comedic partner.
Do you know I have never watched an episode of Absolutely
Fabulous? How dare you?
I haven't. I know nothing about it. I should watch that, actually. Even I feel I should shame myself about that.
I feel humiliated for you. Like it's radiating. Anyway, for those of you who know who Dawn French is, and just she's like, hey, Sophie, what? And she's got all the weird things in her hair and like the extreme makeup.
Yes, yes.
And it just feels like a character.
It does.
And she's telling her about this. She's like, yeah, you're very intuitive, your dreams.
She's very funny on her Instagram, by the way, Dawn French. I know who Dawn French is. I follow her. I just haven't watched Ab Fab.
I like it. You're telling me she's like, she's very, you know, she's very funny.
She's, you know, she's a comedian.
Dawn French really wasn't on Ab Fab. I've explained gay culture to you every time we do on this fucking show. And you know what? I'm not gonna be your fucking do some emotional labor. Learn about gay shit. It's ridiculous. I think there were a lot of sissies out there who, you said, have you never seen it? They just went, what? Anyway, so Don French is basically like, I hate him. I just hate him. He's an actual knob, a knob head. And she said, I just told him, I know. And he started crying.
Oh, he's that pretty crier.
You know what, though? This is one of those guys who can do it and turn it on. And it's kind of dangerous. They can do it. Anyway, and then she said, what are you going to do? Yep. And she said, he's jobless. He's boring. He has no sympathy. He's talking to some dirty, nasty skanks online just so he can get his sausage to explode.
That was the literal word she said.
That was what she used, and it was amazing.
It was amazing. I'm excited for her to be on the
exploding sausage.
And Sophie said, well, she said, okay, well, I don't know. Maybe, and she's, my mom's like, no, I can tell you wouldn't have called me. You're not done, or you wouldn't have called your mom. And so she hangs up the phone, and Sophie's like, well, maybe we can move past it. I need to hear his side.
End it.
Well, I think they just want to be on the show.
I'm so grossed out by these two. Let's move on to something more fun, or is it? Gino and Jasmine.
Y'all, I'm chef's kissing.
When she said, what is this? And it immediately, like, y'all, if it would have been outside, the crickets would have deep, 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 deep.
We just would have heard silence. Like thunder rumbling in the distance.
Everything gets very quiet, like, because even the animals know.
The sight of her leaning on the door frame with that red lipstick going,
I have to go home, Gino.
I did not cheat on you. You did. You didn't fucking cheat.
The way they both yell at each other is so gross.
It's awful.
So horrible.
And so entertaining.
He's like, maybe it was one of my coworkers. And then she realized he just said the wrong thing. She's like, you go out with your coworkers.
I'm allowed to go out with people
I work with. You date your coworkers?
Female coworkers.
Oh, and she goes, I can read Gino. He changed color. This was peak Jasmine
it was
and Gino.
Peak Jasmine and Gino. We might as well, go back to the beginning, but let's talk. And then it ends with Jasmine walking outside in the cold.
I have no passport.
She's like, she doesn't have a phone. She's like, I need to go home. I can't breathe. And then it literally shows her go around to the back of the building by, it looks kind of like a sewage lake or a river, and she's just sobbing.
At one point, she goes, I don't have anything. And the weather could not be more perfect.
It looks terrible. She says it's a metaphor. Let's talk about the beginning where she does say, I felt like we just did this podcast, like when 90 Day Fiancé shows us something dramatic and it says 24 hours before.
Yes.
Jasmine is on the way to meet his family for the first time. And again, I'm still predicting the family Gino with them in Michigan, y'all. The Tony just wearing that cowboy hat all the time. Come on.
I need to meet nephew Anthony.
Whoa.
Tony.
Gabagool.
Oh.
That's some grade A Italian sausage.
Wow. Well, have you seen the photos of Gino when he was young?
He's hot.
Yeah, he's hot. So.
Ooh. Y'all, I guarantee you Anthony's got an Instagram where he's shirtless. He was trying to show off the guns already.
He looked good.
I gotta say, what point they're going to do bocce ball. This is so Italian. I'm surprised there, it wasn't accompanied by And we're meeting Dana, who we've met before, his cousin.
Yep.
Michelle, his wife, brother Tony, Lori, the woman who said, "Hey, don't plan your wedding then, because we're going to Disney World and Legoland."
And now that I've met her and talked to her, I think Jasmine had a right to be offended.
Oh, Tony and Lori are garbage.
Yeah.
Lori are the worst of America. You can just tell, because Tony already says, "So how are you going to be a productive American?"
Yeah.
You're just going to come here and suck off the teat of the system, probably, right? Because someone like me starts paying for you. That, y'all, everything was running between the lines.
Jasmine knew it, too.
She did. Jasmine
was right. She commented on it. Mm-hmm. Because she said, "I don't trust anybody when we're coming here." And she's like, "I have to dress. I have to be covered up." And she said, "I'm going to be friendly, but, you know."
So I liked it when she said this was her professional look. And the skirt was still short.
Very high. But she covered up her boobs. That's why.
It's pouring rain and Jasmine just goes, "Fuck Michigan."
Fuck Michigan. She is... Y'all, unless they get a show, they're going to have to get to Florida pronto.
I guarantee you they'll be in Florida by the end of this next year. No, hand to God.
Yeah.
She will threaten him with an inch of her life. Anyway, so they are, Dana is wearing his best American flag shirt.
Yes.
Message received.
We get it.
They are, Tony basically said, Gino's not the best looking guy. He doesn't have much money. Well, what her real intent is. I honestly think, I really do think in some fucked up way, she loves the man. And did she want to get to America? Possibly. I think she could have found a lot better ways.
I don't actually know if Jasmine really did want to come to America.
That might be true.
She was living a pretty good life in Panama.
Yeah. And Lori's like, "We saw some provocative pics. We think maybe she's trying to pick up some sugar daddies."
That is exactly how she talked, too.
This is Central Michigan trash, y'all. This is straight up. This is what you do as soon as you go outside major cities. These people are... Canton is better than these people. Like, this is bad. Anyway. So it looks like Michelle, who's Dana's wife, might be the only one who's kind of friendly to Jasmine. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, "Thank you for being supportive." And Jasmine hugs her. And then she
even says, "You can always call and talk to me about issues." Yeah.
And then, unfortunately, because Gino can't help but Chantel, he tells Dana about the $4,000 she spent on the butt implant.
On the butt implant. I was screaming and wrote, "No, no, no, stop Chantelling her."
Yeah. And Dana's like, "I don't want to say get her in line." Well, you just did.
You just did.
Y'all are awful. This family's garbage. Anyway.
Great reality TV.
So they're talking about their wedding. And
they're sitting down all to dinner now after they play ball. They're having a drink. And this is where Blonda, what was her name again?
Lori.
Lori, where she really shines. So they're asking about the wedding. And Jasmine says, "Well, I want to have a small wedding because my mother and my sister can't come."
Which maybe just me.
It breaks my heart.
Us and my dog. And I think the dog is what pushed them over the limit.
I agree. It is. I will say, if she had said just Gino and I, but the fact that she's like Gino, me, and the dog, and they're all there.
Something about that. Yeah.
That was shade.
This is one of those things that I think Jasmine needs to compromise on. If she wants to hold out a middle America olive branch the best she can, this is the way to do it. Because inviting, doing a disinvite to your husband's Italian family is not the way to make friends and influence people.
No.
Yikes. So she says, and then was it Anthony the hot one or Tony where she said, so are you really grateful to be here? And I went, oh, y'all are awful.
I feel like that was Tony. Anthony. I'm going to pretend it was Tony and not the hot one.
So then what's interesting is Jasmine says, I sacrificed a lot. I left my family, everything, my job, the weather. She says that. And then Gino says, she really did. She sacrificed a lot. So I'm glad Gino isn't completely Chantelling.
No, he's not.
And anyway, later on, that's when Tony says, how will you coordinate and be a productive American citizen? And she's like, well, I can't work with this visa that I'm on now, so I won't. And then she even says flat out, look, I'm not after his money.
Oh, she does say that. She says, I'm not after his money. And then her talking head says, she's like, this is a personal attack. She calls it out. She says, I will never be good enough because I'm not American.
I think she's dead wrong right.
Yeah, it's xenophobia.
So the family, they're saying, well, you know, I signed a prenup when I married Tony because he had money before that.
Well, no, it was Tony who had signed a prenup because Lori's family, they have money from, I want to say dairy.
Mozzarella factory.
There you go.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's some basically says, I know what Jasmine says. No one here is from anywhere else. And that's why no one has any fucking empathy.
When she said, and I'm that's like, a lack
you're
of empathy.
Throwing truth bombs.
When she said, I went, oh my God, that it is such a condition of everyone's the same. And no one, Americans don't value international travel like other countries do.
Well, they do, but it's to Mexico. And
yeah. To sit on a beach and not get ingrained in a culture.
The Caribbean. Days,
which is fine. Some days, nothing wrong with it. But
right. So Cancun. Cancun, cool.
You do sound like Michigan, Stephanie, and I don't mind. You know, but no, some people
that was, yeah. That, sure, she was from Grand Rapids.
Grand Rapids. But that's true, though. Some people do take, my Aunt Darla just turned 70 last week, and she went to Branson. I told you that. Went far.
The family-friendly capital of the world. How far is that from Oklahoma where she
Branson,
is?
I don't know, like 8 hours, I'm guessing.
That's a long drive.
I don't know. I'm just saying something.
That's a long drive to go someplace that's still landlocked.
I want to look it up while you put on your wig.
You know what? That was what came across my mind. If I'm driving that far, I better be going to a coastal area. But I realized you couldn't do that.
No, not at all. Yeah.
Landlocked state.
Landlocked state.
Was there anything else about, y'all, if you didn't watch, she finds
6 hours and 8 minutes.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
She finds the lip gloss. And I will say, if you don't watch,
oh yeah, wait,
it's kind of worth watching this scene.
Oh, 100%.
Just to see her lose her fucking mind.
It's fantastic.
And Gino, and also the fact that Gino knows she's going to lose her mind.
Knows, and she's like, I can tell when he's lying.
Was there anything else when she's screaming, I want to go back to Panama?
No, I mean, after that, the conversation, like, it always does dissolve, and Gino is yelling at her. She's yelling at him. It's not great, but I, but
it's very entertaining.
Yes, it's very entertaining.
Well, all I know is right now.
Church? When is Mrs. Astor coming over?
Oh, I can, God.
Corsets. Tighter bustle. French service instead of English service. Mr. McAllister.
Oh, Mr. McAllister.
Okay. I'm
it's
not
a good time.
I'm not going to put on the wig.
Oh, because you already put it on.
Already,
the Gilded
I've
Age
put it on.
And The Crown coming in 2 weeks of another is pretty good. That's pretty fantastic.
I feel now this is what I feel like a bad period gay for not watching. I watched the first season and I just haven't caught up.
Oh,
with The Crown.
It's me not knowing Ab Fab is still worse.
It is. It's
it
really
is,
bad.
Yeah, it's really
it's,
bad.
It's almost
I'm
going to
get a lot of messages for that.
Yep. 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 I watched that show way too early.
Oh, like, no, you did everything. Mm-hmm.
Like, I watched it. I think I saw reruns of it as a teenager on some public television station. And I was like, what is this campiness? What is this Patsy and Adina and
like Don French?
That was a gay. Don French wasn't on the show, but that's okay. Jennifer Saunders was.
Yes.
Yeah. I think Don French came on the show as a guest star a couple times.
Ah.
But someone's going to some fucking queer deer is going to school me about Dawn French was on this episode and she was on this episode.
You are. That's what y'all do.
Yeah, I would do that too.
So when does it air? What days?
Sunday, The Gilded Age.
Oh, so you've watched two episodes now.
Two episodes. Y'all, here's what you need to know. This season, let me get to, I actually have Gilded Age. I said, this season has everything. Hats.
Yes.
Lots of hats.
Good.
Laura Benanti as a Mrs. Robinson who is seducing Larry Russell.
Oh.
Yes. And y'all, Laura Benanti is everything. And Opera Wars. Do I need to sell you anymore?
What?
Opera Wars. Yes.
Oh, because they're opening the Met.
The Metropolitan, because they had the Academy of Music that was the kind of the rich, the old money place where the opera were. And now the new money people, because they couldn't get boxes at the Academy of Music, they're saying, we're going to open the Metropolitan Opera. And the old people don't want that coming in. Old money. Bertha Russell is creating an opera war. There's never been a gayer term than opera war, by the way.
Are they calling it opera war?
Yes. And your opera war.
That's great. That is gay, gay, gay.
There was a moment that I watched over and over again where Nathan Lane, who is Mr. McAllister, who literally sounds like Foghorn Leghorn.
He does. He does sound like Foghorn Leghorn.
And he's like, there's a man, Mr. Winchester, who has some very old money, and I hoed. It like he literally said, and I heard it, hide it.
Hide.
Like, the accent Nathan Lane is doing is the campiest motherfucking thing I've ever seen. And it's so gay. Paul Lynde butt fucked Liberace and someone would go, no, what the performance Nathan Lane is doing is gayer.
That's what they would say.
Anyway, Marion has a job painting. Teaching painting, and it's a big deal because she has a job. Oh, can you imagine? Agnes does not like it. And also, we're talking about unions and railroads.
How fitting.
I know. The other thing you need to know is Peggy has returned to 61st Street. One of the worst storylines from last season was, I think, Peggy's finding Peggy's son. And it was kind of like revealed that he had passed away, if you remember. And now there, it was kind of like a, now we're kind of like trying to get past it. And I was like, a child died. This is a kind of a bad storyline. Okay. And I think we all want to get through it, even though Audra McDonald's involved.
That's true.
Anyway, now Mrs. Astor is calling on the Van Ryns to support the new, the Academy of Music and the Opera War. Trying to get her on the thing. And then the last thing I wrote, that we're in Newport, and besides Larry Russell fucking Laura Benanti as the widow, because he's designing her house, they're meeting Mr. Winchester or something like that. And they're like, his wife is very much younger and it's very much a scandal. He'd be great to have a new box at the Metropolitan Opera. And they see him and you see this woman. And he's married the lady's maid who left last season. Remember the horrible one who tried to seduce Mr. Russell?
Yes.
And Bertha said, go back to the house. We need to discuss this. I squealed. I literally went, actually, it was such a high sound, like a little gay mouse. Mm-hmm. And then I ran around the couch.
And a piece of glitter cheese popped out your ass.
I was like, oh. This show makes me do this the same way Downton Abbey, Julian Fellowes' other show, made me do this. The gay twists that this show does. Anyway, y'all, if you're not watching The Gilded Age, I don't know. Throw yourself down a flight of stairs because you need you better.
Yeah, I agree. It's a wonderful, wonderful show.
Anyway, Oscar suit has failed because he was trying to marry Gladys. Remember the daughter? Oscar's the gay
one. I kind of remember that. I have to like.
Because Mr. Russell knows he's a big old flaming homo. Doesn't know it, but he can sense it. Mr. Russell is still daddy.
Wow. Thanks for making it gross.
Always.
Always. By the way, I meant to, this is not like a corner or anything. Maybe I'll have one at some time. I'm sorry, you finished with your corner with.
That has been the Gilded Age Corner. Take off your corsets. Down to the servants' quarters with you.
Oh, Lord.
Heaving bosoms. Lots of heaving bosoms.
Wow.
Now we got to talk about Ashley Manuel.
What I was going to say.
What were you going to talk about? What perspective corner were you thinking about?
It's not a corner. It's just, I just want to recommend to people, because we talked about Britney's a lot, but I'm about 15 minutes into the audiobook of Barbara Streisand's My Name is Barbara.
The one that takes 48 hours to listen to.
Yeah, but I read, but a lot of times if the author's reading it, I'll listen to it on, because I feel like you get to, it's just more, and I was wrong. Michelle Williams is not going to win the Grammy for an audiobook.
Stop.
Barbara Streisand is. It is. Not only is it, it feels like she's not even reading. It feels like
she's telling a story.
You sat down and she's telling you a story. It's so calm. And it's so.
When I was born.
I'm sure she had a ghostwriter and she's been writing this for over like 10 years. But it's actually the sentence structure. It's a beautifully written book. I'm so
excited.
She's
a smart woman.
There's
nothing she can't do.
It is so, but it what it already has in the first 15 minutes, which I know queer people will love it, already you immediately starts with the yearning for Barbara to be something else. The whole introduction is about prologue is about her nose.
Oh my God.
It's delicious.
People who need people are the luckiest people in the world. Groundbreaking. Two fags talking about Barbara Streisand.
Okay, now we can move on.
Riveting.
Riveting, riveting.
Absolutely groundbreaking. Ashley and Manuel. I don't know why this storyline, I keep waiting for the stakes to happen for me, and they're just not. I don't know why. It's either that she's trying to create unrealistic stakes,
mm-hmm.
or like it's almost like she's trying too hard. Because I think the real problem might be the under the radar problem that you don't know how to fucking communicate at all. It's not that you're a witch, honey.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's the problem that you, the problem you don't really want to talk about.
They just do what Poodle did in his 20s. And what's that, Poodle?
When you fight, you fuck.
Yep. They fuck it out, y'all.
It works for a long time.
But it doesn't work, it doesn't work forever, sadly.
It doesn't. And then
I think also you might not be invested in them because I felt this a little bit way, and actually some sissies from the last episodes in the comments, like a lot of them are not fans with Manuel because they feel like, and I kind of see this now too, that like, it's interesting. I think you're dead on when you said Ashley feels like she's creating something out of nothing, and it seems like he's giving her nothing.
I agree with you.
And so it just feels...
He's not taking it seriously.
I don't have a good vibe about him at all.
Yeah, one of two things is happening. I think whether we're getting an edit that is making us suspicious the whole time, like we've gotten before, I think why I say that is because this was a couple that was in all of the promotional trailers. So they've went in for this couple.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm thinking, I think he's getting a bad edit now, and the edit will get better as the season goes. Mm-hmm. I just find the idea that he laughs at the fact I'm a witch. The problem is you don't have the same cultural understanding of the fucking word. And I can't believe we can't find a better word, or it's your pick me-ness that needs to have people have a problem with you being a witch.
Mm-hmm.
You're upset that he would like it if he called you a Satanist or something like that, but he kind of laughs, and that bothers you even more.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's ridiculous to me. This is not the problems they're having, but these are the ones that she's chosen to focus on.
And we don't know anything what he's focusing on, so that's not going that's not going to be a good combination, y'all. Okay.
Go ahead. Did you want to talk about when she said, you know, when you're about to orgasm, you think about something?
That's what I was going to. You can have orgasm manifest, and that's called sex magic. I've heard this before because when you're orgasming, you're at your creative and all. So I have to ask. Because I'm going to regret it.
Oh, you want to hear the real answer, huh?
What, Poodle, when you're having an orgasm, what do you try to manifest?
Here's what I'm thinking. That's what's going on in my brain. And that's the best thing about it. Wiped clean.
Just white noise in there for like 10 seconds.
And it's the most beautiful, blissful sound.
Oh,
because there's
God.
No voices. There's no self-hating. There's just nothing. Just. Ain't no manifestation happening. Because you know what? I already manifested it because I want a dick and I got it.
We need to move on.
Yeah, I don't buy this. What I would tell you is if you're having sex, just enjoy it. Don't I don't know. This maybe I'm old fashioned.
Maybe, but yeah, I concur. Just go be in the moment.
Go for that blissed out. Ooh, this channel's not in service feeling for your head. That's what you're looking for.
All right. So they're going to go to a bar called The Spirit, and they're going to meet her friends.
Spirit Room.
She says her friends can be judged. Y'all, this is the same old 90-day trope. And we see some of our friends. We also see Alyssa and Solly.
Solly, yeah.
Who are married.
I didn't know they were married. I thought they were might have just been friends.
No, she said at one point, she's like, I mean, I'm married to him. She said, we're married and we don't have secrets.
She must be very understanding.
Or they're very open to things.
Yeah. They're also that one gay who was there with his other...
The little white guy with the mustache.
Yeah, he was there.
They're all talking. At one point, you just see him looking like he's sitting on a lemon drop going... I thought we were going to talk about Harry Styles. I thought, has anyone not heard about Joe Jonas's new boyfriend from Devotion?
Her friends are a joke. Like, I can't believe it. Feels like this woman collects just the biggest weirdos.
I liked her friends, and I still like her. I don't know.
It's not that I don't like her.
You do like. I'm saying I would like hanging out with her.
She's exhausting to me.
Probably, but yeah. I bet she gives good advice.
No, she doesn't.
No, I bet she does for other people.
Maybe for other people. Then she's talking about, she's like, he thinks it's comical that I call myself a witch, blah, blah, blah. We know this was in the trailer. We have to talk about it the first part of the season. Honey, no one cares anymore about this.
But Alyssa even says, like, y'all have got to learn your different cultures. And because she speaks Spanish as well, so she can kind of talk about this. But Solly asks, like, go ahead.
What did you think about this? When she's trying to, like, he doesn't speak English at all, obviously. She just stops translating. Did you notice? At one point?
I don't know if that's the edit or not, because I could see them taking that out. I never know. I don't want to. I'll come for someone. Well, but I don't know if we can come for that.
Well, let me explain. She stops translating because she just keeps speaking English, and he just kind of sits there.
No, it looked terrible. I'm just wondering if that's actually what happened.
Yeah,
it was not. If that was the case, it's not a good. It felt very just dismissive.
Well, it made me understand why he didn't want to be there.
Yeah.
He said, I knew I was going to get attacked here, and they're only going to, because he said rightly, the only time she talks to her friends is when I've done something bad. They don't know anything good about me.
Yeah. Yes.
And so he knew that going in. So he's defensive as fuck, and he was acting kind of shitty.
He was.
And he even said, I'm sorry for everything I've said tonight. But you're right. Maybe it was in the edit, but I feel like she just was talking to her friends.
No, I think you could be right, actually.
Yeah. It felt just really bad.
Didn't feel good.
And he gets offended and pissed off. And anyway, I felt like the whole meeting, the friends for the first time, could have been brokered a lot better. Because we've seen this happen where someone's really, but I think she just wanted to bitch about him.
Yeah, I do. And I feel like she talked about how he just like stares at the TV and like he tunes her out. Yeah. So I don't even know if it's that.
This is not the time to complain about your boyfriend in front of him or your fiance in front of him when you're trying to make your friends like him.
Yeah, it's not the way. When people ask, how are your communication? Is you go, oh, good. Doing fine. Like,
and then later on, you take out that one friend we've talked about this before, that one friend who you exclusively pour all your trash about your boyfriend into. Mm-hmm. And they want to murder him. But all your other friends love him.
But all your other friends love him.
And so, then you call that friend when you need to like slash his tires and you need to get even.
You do.
Anyway.
Not that we've ever done that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they decide to go see, they're going to go see a couples therapist. And this is, you know, this is a big deal for Manuel to go to this because this is not in his culture to do this at all.
I was shocked he went.
I was shocked. And he even says, he's like, I have nothing to say to her. No part of me wants this. And Ashley's like, this is preventative. And so we need to have this. The therapist comes in and she sits him and she just, you know, she said, basically asked, is there something you're nervous about? And Ashley starts talking about trust. And that's where she talks about, I don't know if I can trust him or I know he trusts me, but I don't feel like I can trust him. And that's where he says, I feel like I have to deal problems with myself. And she's always accusing me. Who called you this? Who called you this? Da, 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 da. Which I can see is totally, totally true.
Right. Yeah. She does accuse him of lots of things.
She does. And that makes him feel like, but it also, that's where she says he has the laser vision. He just sits there. And Manuel does say this line. And he just says, she gets upset. And that's when I just sit back and enjoy it.
That's not good.
That's and not good.
Yeah. I'm wondering if that was a translation. Because
maybe like,
why would you say that?
I don't take it seriously.
Yeah. Or why would you say that?
Why, boy, he sure smiled slyly. Like he knew what he was saying though.
I think he loves to fuck with her. But the way it was said sounded like he doesn't give a crap about her feelings.
Yeah.
But yeah. He does say, I think I need some privacy. I'm going to say this now. I really do not believe he is ready to get married.
No.
And this, I think this woman's going to have to drag him down the aisle.
Yeah.
Because they'll have to do it. And he,
if he does get married, it's going to make me feel a little doubt and with his family and everything and make me wonder, it was Ashley right.
Yeah. 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 That's the show.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah.
Golly, we talked for an hour.
I felt
that's
every
what
minute.
We usually do. All right, everybody. Thank you. So this was a good episode. So
it was.
We are not watching The Family Chantel. We know that it dropped. We just want to remind everybody that we are right now covering Classless Hay. And after that finishes, we will be caught up on everything 90 days. So we are going to go back and start doing episodes
The Family
of The Family Chantel
from on our $5 season tier. One.
From season one, yes.
All of the foolishness, all of the things that are going to get even stupider.
I hope Mr. Shockey makes another. Shockey
comes
yes,
back.
Shockey,
and the outfits get even dumber,
even
dumber.
So anyway, y'all, that's the deal with that. That's going to be going on. Thank you so much for your support. I hope you're enjoying Double Vibes November. Until later,
someone said they're calling it that. I got spermed and germed.
That's pretty good.
I was like, winner.
Winner!
I was on a Patreon. I got spermed and germed.
Well done, queen. All right, everybody. That's the show. If you wanted to listen to this episode ad-free, you can. You can listen on our $8 tier, or if you don't really want to deal with technology at all and you listen to Apple Podcasts, you can just click on this show that says subscriber only and pay your $8, or actually $7.99, and then you'll be able to get our ads ad-free, our shows ad-free.
Yeah.
That's it. We just don't talk about that enough.
No, you're right. We should.
All right, everybody. That's the show. We'll see you next week. Until then, we call these people lonely hearts because aren't we all just lonely hearts looking for love in all the wrong places?
And if you have in your head like an ASMR on repeat like I do, the Nevers of Nevers of Neverland, you must have watched this week's toe. And we can call it, that's like the Never of Nevers of Neverland. That is seriously in my head on repeat.
God, help me.
It's one of the stupidest things I've ever heard, but it's just in my head.
You're Gilded Age crazy, and we still have to do part two.
I am Gilded Age crazy.
All right, y'all.
Bertha Russell Nuts.
Call us, y'all. Call us.
Church, call us.